Hello everyone. In the previous video, I have discussed with you about the definition of transducer, and I have discussed about different types of transducer. And in this video, I will talk about what parameters you should consider while purchasing or selecting a transducer, and why we should prefer electrical measurement than measurement methods than mechanical measurement methods. And next thing, I will discuss about transducer actuating mechanisms. And from the electromechanical transducer, I will just discuss about the strain gauge. So let's begin with the major parameters which you should consider while selecting a transducer. So from the mechanical suitability, we should consider the transducer size, weight and shape. It should be compact or its size should be small. Because for example, suppose we are measuring velocity, then we keep the transducer in the flow field. So the transducer, the Peter tube or some hot wire anemometer or some velocity measuring device, we keep it in the flow field to measure the velocity. So what happens, this instrument itself act as an obstruction, or it may act as an hindrance which may divert the flow field or which may divert the flow direction. So maybe it causes some changes in the velocity with from the actual velocity. So we should select the transducer which is very compact. Next thing, we should consider the mounting arrangement, how we can fix that transducer to the system of which we are measuring the data, or we are keeping the transducer in the flow environment. So how we will mount the or fix the transducer in that environment. So we have to consider all these things. Next parameter is ruggedness. Ruggedness means it should be able to protect the system or transducer from the overload. Just like in your house, there is fuse connection. When your current increases the beyond certain level, then the fuse burns. Just like similarly, the transducer should have any kind of arrangement that can prevent it from sudden failure or from overload when its measurement value increases beyond certain range. Next thing is range. Range means basically the limit of the transducer. That is the minimum and maximum limit what it can measure. For example, suppose your temperature measuring device, it can measure the temperature from -300°C to +300°C. So that is your range. Your range of that temperature measuring device or transducer is -300°C to +300°C. So you should select the transducer which can measure the minimum to minimum value to maximum value. So it should have high range. Next consideration is electrical suitability. First thing is sensitivity. Sensitivity means it shows the relation between the input signal and output signal. Suppose there is a small increment in the input signal, then how much the output signal increases, that relationship, that means that ratio shows the sensitivity. It is the ratio between the output signal increment to the input signal increment. For example, suppose you are able to hear someone's voice from the far, that means we are telling that your ears are very sensitive. Or suppose you are eating a slight cold thing also, your tooth are getting hurt or you are feeling the pain. So that means we are telling that your tooth are sensitive. So this word, actually you are familiar with this sensitivity word, but in case of transducer, basically the sensitivity for a smallest change in the input signal, it can detect and it will be able to produce significant change in the output. So this transducer should be highly sensitive so that it can detect the minimum to minimum change in the input signal, and it can produce a significant change in the output which you can read, or you can get the information. Basically, when you purchase the instrument, the sensitivity value is given by default. They provide the sensitivity value during the time of purchase, so you have to check that value. So your transducer should have high sensitivity. For example, suppose you are in a pressure measuring instrument, the sensitivity value is given as 1.55 millivolt per Pascal. So you are getting whatever reading you are getting, that is the voltage value. So you have to divide it by the sensitivity so that you can get the pressure value, that means the Pascal reading. So like that, you have to see the transducer which have higher sensitivity. Next thing is frequency response. Frequency response means your transducer input signal and output signal frequency should not vary. That means suppose for example your input signal signals are basically in the form of either sine wave or cosine waves. So suppose your signal input signal is sine omega t. So sine omega t here, your omega phase, there is no phase change, and in this, in the input signal, the amplitude is 1 because it's sine omega t. And what is its frequency? Frequency is omega. So whatever the output signal you will get, so its amplitude or phase may be changed, but its frequency should not change. So suppose the output signal is a sine omega t plus phi. So the input signal is 1, but the input signal's amplitude was 1, but the output signal's amplitude is a, and its phase shift is phi, but its frequency value is omega. So you should select the transducer which produce the output signal frequency, frequency doesn't vary with the input signal frequency. So you should consider those things while selecting the transducer. Next is ease of signal transduction. It should transmit the signal easily. And next thing is resolution. Resolution is the smallest change or smallest increment the device can detect. So these things you should consider while purchasing a transducer. Next thing is environmental suitability. Environmental suitability means your transducer should not be affected by the environmental condition, or it should not sensitive to temperature, and it should not generate heat within itself. It should not change its data by getting affected by the magnetic fields or vibration or dust or humidity. All those things you should consider while selecting a transducer. Next, before measuring the conducting the experiment, we should have to calibrate the device so that we can check that whatever data we are getting, we have to match the results with some standard or reference value, so that we will be sure that whatever data we are measuring or getting, that should be accurate. So it should have high calibration performance. And next thing is it should have desired measurement accuracy. That means whatever data we are measuring, that should be nearer to the accurate or true value. When we do some kind of measurement, we do the repeatability test, so that for a similar set of condition, we are getting the same result or not, we check that. We conduct the experiment 2 to 3 times, similar experiment, keeping all the conditions the same. We do the experiment and we check the data which we are getting in the first experiment are same with the second experiment or not, so that we can we will be sure that whatever data we are getting from the experiment, that is correct, because all the environmental or surrounding conditions are same, or your measurement conditions are same. So in that case, you should get the same result. Next thing is purchase aspects. Purchase aspects means while purchasing a transducer, we should check the cost. It should have minimum cost. Next is why we should prefer the electrical or electronic techniques of measurement than mechanical techniques of measurement. Because the electrical devices in measuring instruments are small, compact in size. That's why they consume less power, and they have less loading on the system to be measured. And because of that smaller size, it is friction and inertia effects are minimum. And we can do non-contact types of measurement because of that electrical or electronics techniques of measurement. And we don't need to touch the measurement device or the transducer with the object of which we are measuring the data. And it has good frequency and transient response. It can respond to sudden change of the input conditions. And it has feasibility of remote indication and recording. It has feasibility of remote indication and recording. That means we don't have to be physically present in the place where the transducer is measuring the data. So we can stay in a different field and we can collect the data from the computer or from the system, and we can get the data, and we can observe the measuring environment also from a different location, other than staying in the location where your transducer is measuring the collecting or getting the data. Next thing is we can amplify the signal which we are measuring from the electrical or electronics methods of measurement, and we can do all kind of mathematical modification with the signals like summation or integration. From so for example, from a velocity or acceleration data, we can from the acceleration data we can get the velocity, and from the velocity we can get the displacement. Like that, we can convert one form of signal to one variable to another variable, doing all kind of post processing. So these are all the advantages of electrical and electronic techniques of measurement. Next is the transducer actuating mechanism. Actuating mechanism means how it can respond to the particular input signal and how it behaves or how it produces the movement with respect to that signal. So these are a few actuating mechanisms, like these are flat diaphragms and corrugated diaphragms and capsule. Capsule is basically two corrugated diaphragms. They are welded opposite to one another. So when what happens when the some kind of wave signal wave or when the flow field or fluid, because of the suppose it is measuring the pressure, then because of the flow pressure it basically deflects and produces the movements. So and another types of actuating mechanisms are bellows and circular Bourdon tube. We have seen that because of the fluid pressure these tubes they expand and they produce a significant displacement. And next one is the corrugated Bourdon tube, you can see from the image. So these are few actuating mechanisms, and this bellows and this pivot torque mass cantilever stay tube. Pivot torque basically they are used as a rotary actuator, and mass cantilever it is used as an actuating mechanism in case of force measurement. And so basically the flat diaphragms they are used in microphone, pressure transducer, force measuring transducers. Corrugated diaphragms also used in the same place. Capsule, I've already told you, basically two corrugated diaphragms, they are joined opposite to one another, and it is basically used in the pressure measuring devices, and the pressure inlet line is provided at its middle position so that when the pressure enters in the capsule that it deflects. So that according proportion of from the from the displacement you can get the proportionate pressure value or reading. Bellows are the elastic vessels that can compressed when the pressure applied at the outside of the vessel or extend under vacuum. So these are this can act as an actuating mechanism because it produces the movement while responding to certain force or pressure.